So after the hypothesis testing, we should also know how to quantify a potential difference between two things, including the uncertainty about such a quantification. That is called a confidence interval. We can do that also for the comparison of two, and here it comes, smashed up in your face right away. What is the method of the confidence interval for the difference between two means? Well, we take the observed sample difference between the two means, we say plus minus the t statistic, or the critical value for the t, roughly this number two-ish thing, right? At least with 95% and with n not too small, this is roughly two. And then we say two times what you could call the standard error of the difference of the means, or the sampling uncertainty of the difference of means, or the standard deviation of the way that the difference between two means could vary from sample to sample, or what should I mean, to two samples to two samples, right? How could, I'm having my two samples in front of me, nine nurses here, nine nurses here. I compute the mean here, sample mean, the sample mean here. I compute the difference between the sample means. I want to use this, was roughly two in our data, right? I want to use this two as the best estimate of the real difference between the mean energy expenditure by these two populations, these nurses here in general and these nurses here in general. If I should be intelligent about how good that number is for that purpose, I should think about what could happen if I took another sample tomorrow or next week. I do the study again. I take a new sample of nine nurses from this hospital and a new sample of nine nurses from the other hospital. And I compute the mean again. Would I get the number two again? Or would I get something completely different? That's the thought you should have as an intelligent engineer when you report the difference between two means that comes from somewhere, whether it's in your company or in wherever you work. If you report the difference of two means, you should ask yourself, is this a good number? Can I really believe that this is the true number? If my colleague do the study tomorrow, will he get a different number? What is the variability of this number? What could it be differently from sample situation to sample situation? Whoa, magic, I had a stats course, I got the theory. I know what the sampling distribution and the sampling uncertainty is. I know what the standard error of the difference of two means is. It's just the sum of the two sampling errors from each individual mean. That's the variance, sampling variance, and then I root it, I have the sampling standard deviation. So I'm just using a lot of words for a concept that we discussed already. Now we just use it for the comparison of two things rather than a single mean. It's the same line of thinking. So I just repeat once again, I think for the third or fourth time today, or at least in the course, just to remind us, it's not easy to see, but of course it's the x bar minus the y bar, two averages. We have the acceptance region and we have the rejection areas. The confidence intervals are those values that we accept by the hypothesis test. The ones that are outside the confidence interval are the ones we would reject by the confidence interval. So the confidence interval consists of the acceptable or everyday language plausible values for the difference of the two means. Example. We could find the critical value with 16 degrees of freedom, and in a sec I'll go into R and do it. And then we could compute the confidence interval by taking the two means once again. This was the approximate two number for the difference of two means. I look up the t number, that is the other approximate two number, this from the t distribution, and I plug in the two variances and the n's, and I get the result I already showed you on slide 2 35 minutes ago. And this is the way to jump into R to actually do it. If you have, this is one way of having data, a simple way. If you have two separate vectors like that, you might do it by simply calling t-test. It's the same function that we used last time for single sample data, right? But if you tell it that there are two like that, it will do a two sample t-test by default. And it will by default. It also tells you what it does by default. If you don't tell it anything else, it does the hypothesis test of this delta being equal to zero. That's the default test given by the procedure. This also tells us that this is probably the mostly used version of this, because this is the default of the t-test function in R, generically. Two inputs, it does this. It does this version. It has a name, and we'll at the end I'll show you why it has sort of an additional name, this Welsh two-sample. Why don't we just call it the two-sample? There is a different version. We don't really use it here, but it exists, so I'll show you at the end of the lecture that there's another version. But the default version is this one. It gives us the t-test statistic, rounded off. That was 3.01, right? The one when we computed it before. It tells us the degrees of freedom, rounded off. 15.99, that was rounded off to 16 here. It gives us the p-value that we already saw. It also gives the 95% confidence interval, so everything is here just by calling this t-test function. It basically uses the formulas that I just showed you to give you both the hypothesis test and the confidence interval, and we have everything for the conclusions and the interpretations that we are interested in given such a situation. I have high expectations once again. I have also high expectations to my own ability to actually have picked the right answers. That's not too bad. Okay, good job. The alpha level is a risk level of our procedure of doing hypothesis testing. It's the risk level that defines the acceptable chance of claiming that we have rejected a null, even though it was not the right thing to do. It is the risk level that we are willing to accept to have someone, a medical company, to claim that a drug has an improved effect compared to another drug. And we allow ourselves that there is a certain risk that they could have been wrong when they say it's improved. That's the type 1 risk. I should say that to get on the market with drugs, there is a quite strong, it's not enough with a single study of 20 persons, and also for health authorities to give recommendations on what we should eat and shouldn't eat, they use more than a single 20-person study. There are something people talk about, meta studies, where you require from you or the companies that you buy several studies or by meta investigation can have support of your findings. So it goes to a meta level often also. Let's move on.